things that most people don't know. We use God's commandments to see if it's true or not. So the ninth commandment says you're not to tell a lie. Have you ever told a lie? Raise your hand.
Right here.
Wow, everybody lie. Okay, if you tell a lie, what do you call if you tell lies? What do they call you?
Liar.
Liar, very good. The 10th commandment said we're not to steal. Don't take anything that doesn't belong to you, regardless of its value, big or small. Have you ever done that? There we go, all the hands go up. So what do they call people who take things that don't belong to them? What do you call them?
Thieves.
No, that's a football team. Pittsburgh Steelers. Yeah, very good. Now watch. Let's help him with this thing. See, if you take something just one time, doesn't matter. You've done it, it's, you get it, you broke the law. They don't put you in jail because you take it five times, you steal one time and get caught, you're in jail. The difference here is you won't get caught until you die. This is what we're talking about now. Right. The third commandment says you're not to commit blasphemy.
President!
Not to commit blasphemy. That's when you take God's name, you use it as a holy, you know, as a filthy, dirty word, you know, the JC and the GD. You know, anybody ever do that?
Yes.
Huh? You ever done that? Yeah, swear. Swear. Taking God's name, the JC. Look at that.
But I'm a good person.
Look, why? Think about it. You guys may not know this, but in the Bible, it's very clear. He says, he will not hold that person guiltless. God will not hold that person guiltless who takes his name in vain. Think about it. You just swear one time, and you're in big trouble. Then why do we do it? What did he do to us? I mean, the fact that you guys are here, God created man to begin with. Then from there, we all been born, and we're born, and we're born, and we got new gender. And here you are. And you get married, and you can have kids as well. That's God's blessing. And you use his name and swear as a curse word. Think how ridiculous that is. Why don't you use Saddam Hussein or Adolf Hitler? They were the bad guys.
Oh, Hitler!
Yeah, there you go. They were the guys that killed 6 million Jews. We love them, probably. That's sad. So if you've done that, you're in big trouble. One more, we're done. The seventh commandment says you're not to commit adultery. Before you answer, Jesus said, if you just look at another person and you lust after them, you know, sexual desires you want, you've already committed adultery with them in your heart. So who here has looked at another person with lust?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so here we go. Everybody's admission. You're all a bunch of lying thieves, you're blasphemers and adulterers at heart, and you're right. You're not a good person. Absolutely right. Yeah. But it's not just sin, because people don't know what sin is. Because if you knew sin was wrong, like in your case, you wouldn't be lying and stealing and fornicating and swearing, if you knew it was wrong. You don't think it's wrong. People justify their sin. The Bible says that. So here's the sad part. You know how to try to push marijuana, I'll use that instead of alcohol, and that guy's back up with the marijuana in his truck, and he jumps the guy, and bam, now he kills us all and hits us with his truck. We're all dead. And now you're facing a holy God. How do you think God would find you based on those commandments? You've only done four. There's six more to go. But would you be innocent or guilty in his eyes? What do you think? Innocent or guilty? Now you're innocent. Well, he's amazing. He's a bad guy, but now he breaks the law.
I'm a terrible person.
And you
well,
be innocent?
Jesus.
Well, accepting it isn't going to help you. So what would you be, innocent or guilty? To even that point, listen, the fact that he says he jumps to accepting, why would he accept them? He better admit it to being guilty. And he hasn't. You get it? I'm not just picking on you.
I admitted that I was guilty.
God, you said I was a bad person.
This is being honest.
But he said guilty. How would God find him?
Guilty.
We didn't get to that part yet.
No.
If you broke the law, and you're in front of the judge, how would the judge find you? Innocent or guilty? There you go. And if he was guilty, where would he then have to send you? Heaven or hell? God, where would he have to send you? Heaven or hell? Hell. Very good. That's true. That's the sad part. Now here comes the question. Does that concern any of you that it's a possibility? Based on your present lifestyle, you could be headed for hell. Because it's just me. I'm the one that's concerned about it because I'm out here. I wouldn't want anybody to go to hell. That's why we're here witnessing to you people. Does it concern anybody? Are you worried about it? If that's a possibility, you could be headed for hell. A little bit. Okay, how about you? Anybody else worried about it?
Of course.
Huh? Oh, that's pretty sad if it's every day. In a way, that's good. You should think about it. See, I find many people don't even believe in hell. In their own mind, they go, oh, there is no hell. God's too loving. He wouldn't send anything. Then it's crazy what they come up with. So if you understand the fact that's a possibility, now comes the best part. What did God do for us so we wouldn't have to go to hell? Huh?
Son.
Gave his only son. Well, again, that doesn't help too much. The point is, he died on the cross. Not he, but Jesus. See, it was Jesus Christ, his only begotten son. John 3:16. He sent him to what? To pay the fine the penalty, take the penalties to the crimes of Tom. See, I was a scumbag, just like you guys. There you go, right. So we all scumbags. There you go. I want you to understand that. Now what? Now he says you have to do two things, and this is what's never usually mentioned. You need to repent, and then you trust in Jesus Christ alone for the forgiveness of your sins. If that happens, you won't be, I'm not picking on you, but you won't be like him and worried about it every day. Because then you're not trusting on the person who paid the fine. You understand that connection? You know, like if I was in jail and someone came to me and said, Tom, let's change clothes, I'll wear your stripes, and you can take my suit, and that way you can go home, you'll be free. And I say to him, well, I don't know if I want to believe that. Because I wouldn't trust him, would I?
Yeah.
Well, that's what you're saying. So here's the part of repent and trust. So the repenting has to do with a 180, like this. You don't continue down that road. You're not going to lie. You're not going to steal. You're not going to swear anymore. No lust, no sex, not a marriage. You've got to be married first. See? Also, the problem is what? Well, the other one we brought up, swearing. You guys, I hear it all the time. I also do Tempe. I'm on the college on Saturday nights. And that's all that walks by me. They're just like every other word is all I know how to talk about. It's terrible. There's no reason to do that. And that's where the repentance comes in. And you turn away from that. You walk down that path. Now you're going to honor God. You walk towards God. You don't walk towards man to try to blend in with everybody else. Now, none of you qualified for the good person test for the closure, correct? No, right? Okay. But watch, in the Bible, see, we're going to be good. It says that God, by grace, has given us this benefit. It's Ephesians 2:8-9, it's not my statement. It says that grace you can save, it's a gift from God, not of works, so that no one can boast. Get it? When you get a gift, what you do to get it? What did you do to get a gift? Yeah, there you go. See, so it's by grace you've been saved, a gift from God, not of works. And all the religions that are out there, you name your major religions, and they all wrote good works to get you here. Catholicism, Mormonism, the Seventh-day Adventist, all of them is about how good you do. So what about Jesus then, see? The fact that he died on a cross to save us from sin is meaningless because as long as I take care of the poor, I give money to charity, I go to church on Sunday, I'm good enough, I'll get to heaven. Then I don't need him. Never trust. Okay? So I know what he did. I repent. I got to turn from my sin. I put my trust in him alone for the forgiveness of my sin. And once you do that, he said, your sins are wiped clean, past, present, and future. Awesome. Got it? You don't live that same lifestyle anymore. But always remember, if someone ever says to you, how would God find you, don't say, I'm saved. Or I accept it to God. Say, I'm guilty. And then give him the reason why you're not. It makes more sense, doesn't it? See, because just to accept Jesus for no reason, get it? Where's the guilt? Yeah, how about this? You know, my life isn't that great. I'm an alcoholic. I'm going to get a divorce. Well, you just accept Jesus and you'll be okay. Okay, I'll do that. I accept Jesus. I accept Jesus. There's nowhere in the Bible where it says accept Jesus. Nowhere. How's that? Jesus said, repent. He says, unless you're born again. And here's the cutest one. He said, unless you become like little children, you'll never enter the kingdom of heaven. Think about what that means. What does a child do? You guys are younger yet.
Nothing.
A child trusts. Okay? If I got my granddaughter, I'm old enough, my granddaughter said, come on, let's go. Addison, we're going this way. She doesn't say, well, what time are we going to come home? How long are we going to be here? She says, okay. Right? That's trust. See, that's why he said, unless you be, it doesn't mean we got to become little again. The mindset of a child trusts the adult. You got that part? So you're entitled to the glow stick because it's a free gift? Reach up and take the one you want. Before you go here, I want you to read this.
This is my first round.